Amen. Good morning, folks. Amen. Good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen. Amen. You could be somewhere else, but you're blessed enough to be here, right? Amen. I have got several announcements, so if you could settle down and give me your ear, that would be wonderful. It's expected from you. All right. Bridal shower for Ashley this Tuesday at 6 o'clock. It is a bridal shower. Whatever you bring for the bride. A muzzle for Matt, for her. I don't know. Whatever you come up with. Iron skillet for Matt. No, I don't think so. No, whatever. But I guess it's kind of like feminine stuff or whatever.
Or a nice new rifle.
Ooh, yeah. But she ain't gonna shoot him now.
She's got the way around.
The shirts for Bible school needs to be, the orders need to be given in by this Wednesday, is that right? So give it to my wife or give it to the other person. So who ain't up here swinging, wherever she is. We're gonna be taking two offerings up today. The second will be for one voice. Men's fellowship tomorrow, May 7th. And then upcoming, we'll have a women's fellowship be the following week. So if you could, try to come out and attend that tomorrow at, I believe it's 6:30. Is that right, Bobby? All right. So you'll be blessed if you come out. Amen? Also, we had a good time in Sunday school this morning talking about giving. If you're not a giver, amen, you have to wonder whether Christ is in you. For the Bible says that's all he did was give his life away to other people. Amen. Don't always have to be money. But it can be time, love, and effort. Amen? Amen. Let me give you the prayer list this morning as we get rolling. Tommy Vance needs our prayers as we pray. He's going to have open heart surgery. Tony Klein needs our prayers. Linda Lester with cancer needs our prayers. Jordan Mitchell, Josh Morgan, Tammy Morgan, Anthony S., Adam, Nathan, and Frankie Bradford. Frank Bradford, Peggy, Kevin, Mike, and family. Also on the list this morning is Rhonda, Katie Carter, says having a reaction to chemo, needs her prayers. Brianna Hash, traveling to D.C. with her school, traveling mercies. Elizabeth Hash, her fourth nasal surgery tomorrow. Unspoken requests, Sister Maxine Bishop with her appetite. And Brother Jerry Lee Klein's on the list this morning. Anybody else want to cast any right before the throne? Go ahead, Brother Jack. Remember Jack and Linda as we pray. Anybody else? Donna Coleman, is that what you said? Garnet. Okay, gotcha. All right, anybody else? All right, well, if you would, let's just gather around the altar and wait for you to come before the Lord in prayer this morning.
Inside of our hearts today. We're thankful and grateful for that. We're thankful, Jesus, that you came to give us life. And you said you came to give us a more abundant life. And we're so thankful for that. Came to give us eternal life. And Lord, we're just so thankful that we have eternal life now. And I'm so thankful and grateful for that today. So thankful for that hope we have today. And that is Christ in us, the hope of glory. We're thankful today that, once again, that our feet have been led to the sanctuary of God. Thankful today, as David said, I was glad when they said, let us go unto the house of the Lord. I'm thankful today that our feet have been led here today. So thankful that we can come together under one roof with your people. And we can come together with people like Precious Faith, and we can come together to worship the living God today. What an honor it is to be here today. What an honor it is to be able to come before the throne of God today. to be able to come with boldness, that we can find grace to help in time of need, that we can come together with you, with your people, under one roof, to make a joyful noise unto heaven today, that we can come together to praise our God. We can come together today to worship the living God. What an honor it is to be able to do that. What a privilege it is today to be able to have the liberty to come together, to have the liberty to raise our hands and to open our mouth in praise, and just to be able to worship you today. My, what a privilege it is today. You're a good God, and you've given us a good salvation. And every good and every perfect gift we know comes from the Father of lights. It comes from above. And so we give you praise today for the goodness of God in our life. Because we know that everything good in our life is a direct result of the goodness of God in our life. I know that everything that we have in our life is a blessing from God. The good things of life, it comes from you. And we just give you praise today. Give you glory today. So thankful today to know that you're the Savior today. The Savior of all mankind. We give you praise today. Thankful that you're the healer of our body today. To know that by your stripes we are healed today. To know that you provided everything that we will ever need in this life. You provided in the atonement. And I'm so thankful and grateful for that this morning. To know that you've given us all things pertaining to life and godliness. That whatever we need, you've already provided. For you daily load us with benefits. And we're thankful and grateful for your provision in our lives today. My, what a God you are. What a great God you are. Moses said, there's none like you in all the earth. You're marvelous in holiness and you're doing wonders. And my, what a wonder-working God you are. We come together today to magnify your high and holy name today. We come in this house today just to give you praise and glory and honor. Just to acknowledge from our heart the goodness of God. We're so thankful and grateful for that. Today, Father, I plead the blood over every need on that prayer list today. Every name that went up today, every need that went up, we know you're a God that knows. You're very well acquainted with every one of us. Very hairs of our head are numbered. You're so well acquainted with us. And so we know that you know the deepest need of our life for today. I know every individual in this room here today, you know personally. And I just bring each one before you. You know those that are ready to meet God, those that are not. You know those that are in need today. You know every need in this building today. My prayer today is that every need will be met today. My prayer today is that every individual in this room will turn to you today as our source, because you are our source today. There's no other life outside of God. You are our life totally. You are our life completely. And may, Father, your people today turn to you. May every heart in this room today leave this room today better equipped than when they came. May we leave today knowing that we've been in the presence of the Most High God. I pray that every believer will take the advantage of the opportunity we have here today to worship you. I pray that every believer will turn their heart to heaven today. And they will on purposely raise their hands to heaven and open their voice with praise to the living God. I pray that every believer in this house today will create the atmosphere that the miracle worker can have liberty in. Holy Spirit, we need you today. We need you to come. We desperately need you to come. We give you permission to come. We want you to come and dwell among our midst here today. So help us that we can create the atmosphere that you can have liberty in. Help us here today. And we can leave this house knowing that we've been in your presence. But let us open our hearts to you. Let us lift our hands and open our mouth in praise to the living God. For you inhabit the praises of your people. We ask you to come. Help us, I pray, that we can create that atmosphere that you can have liberty in. That you can accomplish the will of God in. I'm not sure what the will of God is for these your people, but you know, Holy Spirit. So we invite you to come because you're our helper today. You're our comforter today. And there's some here that need help. There's some here that need comforting. There's some here today that needs a counselor. And you're our counselor today. And we invite you to come and meet the need of your people today. We need you to come in this meeting. So come and breathe upon us here today. And do what only you can do in our midst. And Father, we'll give you praise for everything that's accomplished in this house here today. For we ask it in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Ushers, if you would, receive the Lord's tithes that are offering in him this morning. And they're going to wait on you again for the second offering for food for angels. Bless the offering for us, if you would, Brother Gary.
that the pastor was speaking about suddenlies. Hallelujah. And my husband had texted me this week about a suddenly. And the word talks about how they were gathered in the upper room. Hallelujah. And how that suddenly there came a sound out of heaven as a mighty rushing wind. Can we press in this morning, brothers and sisters? This could be the morning for a suddenly. Hallelujah. This could be the morning that God suddenly reveals himself to us in a greater way. This could be the morning that he suddenly manifests himself in a way, hallelujah, that we have not known. This could be the day that suddenly your children come back to God. This could be the day that suddenly your body is healed. This could be the day that suddenly deliverance comes to our families. This could be the day of suddenly, hallelujah. So let us lift our hands and get lost in his presence this morning. It doesn't matter what song we sing. One more time. would know us because of our preaching, that they would know us by our singing, hallelujah, our shouting or our dancing, and all those things are wonderful, but he said they will know you because of the love that you have for one another, hallelujah, praise God. Brother Mike was talking about already this morning about how God is a giver, and we know the Bible says that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, hallelujah, he gives us his love. Awesome, wonderful, reckless love that we can give it to others. Hallelujah. And that way, that's the difference that is supposed to be in us. The love of God flowing out from us to those that feel unloved. Hallelujah. Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You've been so, so so if you know you have received the love of God in your life, hallelujah. And I can tell you that every one of us in here has received the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. And while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us, hallelujah. We have all received His love, and it's by His loving kindness and His mercy, and we are here and breathing this morning, and that He gives us chance after chance after chance, hallelujah. A few moments and respond to the love that God has shown to us. God, we bless your name this morning, Jesus. We thank you, Lord, for the love that you have poured out and lavished upon us that we don't deserve and we can't earn, but yet you keep giving and giving and giving your love. And we thank you for it, Lord. We thank you for your love this morning, God. We thank you that we're not left hopeless. We're not left comfortless. Oh, but we have precious promises of Christ. Precious granted, precious promises through you, God. And we praise you. We praise you for those promises. Sometimes we're ashamed in church and somebody might see us raise our hands or cry or bow upon our knees. Hallelujah. But I want to tell you this morning, Jesus was never ashamed of me and my filth and my dirt and my sin and my mess. He was never, ever, ever ashamed of me in my shameful behavior. He was still never ashamed of me. And He came to this earth and He made Himself of no reputation. He humbled Himself. He let them mock Him. He let them make fun of Him and spit on Him. Hallelujah. And ultimately kill Him. He laid down His life for me. He was not ashamed of me. And He is not ashamed of you. So, oh God, forgive me. Forgive me for every time I have been ashamed to express my love for you, God. My praise for you, God, the way that you deserve it. God, forgive me, Lord, for nothing that man can think about me matters, God. Nothing that man can do to me matters. I care not, God. I will be a fool for you, Lord. Hallelujah. Let us cast aside our shame and our worries, our pride, and our fear of what man will think. And let us worship Him. Let us worship Him with abandon. Let us, if we really would worship Him, hallelujah, the way He deserves to be worshipped. If we would really worship Him the way He deserves to be worshipped, our church services would be much different. Our corporate gatherings would have a completely different atmosphere. But until we become free enough to worship God the way He needs to be and deserves to be worshipped, we are not, I'm just going to, we will not see a move of God. The old saints of God did not care. They danced before God. They laid on their faces before God. They wept before God. They raised their hands before God. Hallelujah. You can say it's emotionalism if you want to. You can say it. Hallelujah. But I'm telling you that God has touched my emotions. How could I not be emotional about someone who came and laid His life down for me when I did not deserve it? How could I not be emotional about someone who loves me this way? How could I not have some kind of response? Do you not respond to your family? Do you not desire to show love to your family? Hallelujah. We desire to shower our families with gifts and to comfort them and to be with them and to celebrate them. Hallelujah. When are we going to learn to celebrate our God? When are we going to learn to celebrate our God? Hallelujah. You know, there's a man who preaches. His name is Francis Chan. And Francis Chan is not a really emotional, outwardly emotional person. Hallelujah. But I heard him preach a message on praise. And yeah. He was talking about how that when Jesus came into Jerusalem, hallelujah, how they were waving the palm branches and taking off their coats and throwing them down on the road. Hallelujah. Yeah. As he came in riding on a donkey, and how they were shouting out for him. So much so that the Pharisees were saying, shut him up. Tell him to shut up. They were crying. They were making such a commotion over him. And Francis Chan said, that's what our praise should look like. This man who is not very emotional, he said, that is what our praise should look like. He said, it should look like that. Hallelujah. It should look like that. We should be celebrating. We should be praising. We should be loving our God, not in response to a song on a platform, but in response to God. In response to his worth, his goodness, his holiness, his love. I don't worship him based on a song. If I worship God based on a song, my worship is not worship at all. For what happens when a song goes away? What happens in the middle? I have to have my own song that comes out of my heart. That's worship. That's praise. Hallelujah. That's what it is. And if we could just begin to let go of it, as long legacy as we say, we don't need that. That's not necessary. That's not necessary. The church doesn't need that. We've moved beyond that. We sure have moved beyond that. We've moved beyond it to a place of no power. Hallelujah. A place of no power. We've moved right beyond into a beautiful program with no power, where people come in addicted to drugs and walk out the door addicted to drugs. Where people come in sick with cancer and walk out the door sick with cancer. Where people come in with sin in their lives and walk out the door with sin in their lives. Yeah, we've traded it off. We don't want to get emotional. We don't want to get out of order or out of control. Hallelujah. So therefore, we've got it all controlled, Brother Rick. We control it all in our box, God and all. He can only move, hallelujah, the way we say he can move. God, you can only do this. You can only do this in this time frame. This is the only way that you can move. You can only move through this song. You can only move through this message. This is the only way you can move. Hallelujah. But God is looking for some people who are no longer worried about the status quo. They don't care what people think. They're not worried about a program. They don't want to keep God in the box. Hallelujah. But they say, God, whatever you want to do, we need it. We want it. Because if we don't see something different, we will die. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father God, move. Move in this place this morning. Mess me up, God. I don't care, God, what I think is supposed to look like, God. Let this begin to be what you want it to look like, Father God. Let our services begin to be what you have for them, God. Oh, God, help us, Lord. We are in great need of you. We are in great need of you. Hallelujah. The thing I was thinking about this morning, the Bible talks and says, these signs shall follow them that believe. And it talks about how we should lay hands on the sick and they will recover. That we will cast out devils in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Speak with other tongues. If we drink any deadly thing, it will not harm us. These signs shall follow them that believe. I don't need a sign and a wonder to believe. Hallelujah. I believe because God's Spirit is on the inside of me. I believe because I believe His Word. And by faith, I believe His Word is true. And He came to the earth. Hallelujah. And gave His life for me. And by faith, I accept Him. But the Bible says it's not the sign and wonder first and then the believing, but it's the believing and then the sign and wonder. So I had to ask myself, have we really believed? Because it says these signs shall not might follow, maybe follow, should follow. These signs will follow them that believe. Church, it's time that we rise up to that stature. It's time that we get to that place. That we believe, hallelujah. And our believing results in these signs following, hallelujah. And I will never, if I go to my grave, Pastor, if I go to my grave and I never see a dead person get up, if I never see somebody just miraculously healed in front of me, I will still believe that that is what God, that God still works that way. I will still believe that God works. If I never see it, I will still believe that God works that way. Because His Word is true. His Word is true. And God wants to break out of the box that we have put Him in and move. Move for His people. Hallelujah. He said they'll know us by the love we have one for another. You know what? I was thinking the other day. about there's a little baby right now, hallelujah, that's recently been diagnosed with cancer. And so many out there that have cancer, hallelujah, more than just that baby. And I was thinking about how, Jesus was moved with compassion when he healed these people. When the widow woman's son was dead, it talks about how he was moved with compassion, hallelujah, and he raised her son. It was love that compelled Jesus to heal. Love. And I thought, my God, you look at people and you want to be able to touch them and help them. Pastor, I'm my sister-in-law right now. Her father has cancer. Hallelujah. And if God does not intervene, he will not stay in this world. And I know that he's saved. And I know that he'll go to be with Jesus. But his family is suffering right now. They are hurting. My God, what would it be like, Pastor, to be able to go to that man in the power of God and lay my hands on him and see him walk out completely and totally cancer-free? Hallelujah. God wants that for his people because he loves us. And he wants us to love others in that way. We love in many ways, but I'm telling you, signs and wonders are love. They are loving people. We love people by giving and meeting their physical needs and giving food and clothing and shelter and being there for them and listening to them and counseling them and giving them the word of God. But signs and wonders are for love too. They are for love too. That you could go to a grieving family whose child has died and tell them to get up and they would get up from the dead. Hallelujah. That's love. That's love. So many times before Jesus would heal or raise somebody from the dead, it says he was moved with compassion. Moved. He was moved with love. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is love that will bring these things about. And we've got to get to the place where the church operates in that way. Come on, sing to him this morning. Sing to him this morning. Thank him for his love. Thank him for his overwhelming love. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, restless love.
Praise this morning. Would you do me one favor before I get started this morning, before we go any farther? Will you do your pastor one favor this morning? Will you stand on your feet all over the building? If you're not crippled, you can't get up. You can remain seated. But if you could stand with me, would you? All over the building, would you? Would you just take 30 seconds and raise both hands to heaven and just begin to thank him for this reckless love of God that chased you down, would you? Come on, church. Come on. Come on. Come on. Put your hands up and just take, all I ask you is 30 minutes. Just 30 minutes of just 30 minutes of thanksgiving for this reckless love of God that chased you down one day, found you in your miserable state, reached down, got you, and changed you. What a love, 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 what a love. I don't need any music. I don't need anybody to lead me into kind of worship right now. I just want to raise my hands and I just want to thank you for this never-ending, reckless love of God. The love that chased me down one day. The love that came into my life and turned my life upside down and inside out. The love that changed me. Changed me from a wreck. Changed me. Oh, that love of God that reached further down than I could reach up. The love of God that invaded my dark life. The love of God that came in the midnight hour of my life. The love of God that reached down into the deep resources of my soul and gave me a hope and gave me a life and gave me a purpose and gave me a reason to keep on going. I thank you for this love of God that has been shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost. We're so thankful and grateful that today that we were born again, the love of God was poured in our heart by the Holy Ghost. I'm thankful that you opened my heart up and poured the love of God down on the inside of me. And because you love me, I can love today. And the only reason I can love is because God loved me first. And my love is in response to your love. But oh, the love of God. Oh, the love of God. The love of God, the love of God. Oh, the love of God. You're right, I didn't earn it, and I sure to God didn't deserve it. But you give yourself away. Oh, glory to God. Thank you for this love of God. Oh, that willingly and sacrificially went to an old rugged cross. Shed all of your life's blood. Gave you a life so that I could have life. And have it more abundant. What a love of God. What a love. Wow, what a love. What a love. What a love. Hallelujah. What a love. What a love. Glory to God. Come on, Kelly. Come on. Praise God. What a love. You can be seated in the presence of God. Hallelujah. I know it's getting a little late, but we're just going to do it anyway. Come on, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise God. Thank God for his love today. Thank God for his love today.
Amen.
Thank God for his love today.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Glory to God. Glory to God. What a marvelous love today. Wow.
Yeah. I believe there are streets of gold, but it's all right. If there's nothing more than one old gravel road, and I know mansions waiting, but a cabin suits me fine. Just a place where I can rest my heavy load. Oh, they say there is a river that flows beneath the throne, and the surface there reflects that holy place. Oh, I'm sure that all the splendor will be so grand to see, but what I long to see the most is Jesus' face. lights of that fair city will never fade away. It's the perfect land where night will never come.
Amen.
But all the beauty I'll behold there can't compare to how I'll feel when I hear my precious Lord say, "Well done." 'Cause that's all that matters to me.
Amen.
To bow my head and make my blessed Savior on my knees. On those peaceful hills of glory in His presence I will be. To know I'm home, that's all that matters to
Goode, is he not?
Amen.
Anybody thankful for the goodness of God?
Amen.
Amen. God is so good. Amen. God is so good. He's an awesome God.
Amen.
He's an awesome God. Let me make just a couple now, right quick, and then we're going to move right on and get this thing going today. First of all, I want to welcome Ben Noble here with us today, all the way from. He lives in Wells. He's from New Neck of the Woods. He's from Stewartsville. That's Wells, West Virginia, man. Yeah. He's originally from Marianna, Florida, right? You know, we have a Marianna right down the road here. You know that right there? Just in case you want a little bit closer to the church. Just a little bit closer to the church. There's Marianna right there. You'll feel right at home. Just a little bit different than Florida. Just a little bit steeper. I found out that he works over at the federal prison over McDowell County, and he works with my son. As soon as he told me that, I looked at his mom and I said, "He takes after her. Don't get me. I didn't have nothing to do with that." Don't hold that against me, brother.
Yeah.
Amen. I don't know what happened to him. I don't know what happened to him. He was doing pretty good there at one time, but I don't know what happened to him. Also, don't forget this coming Saturday, May the 12th at 7 o'clock, we'll be here for a Saturday evening service. And Brother Matt Campbell, where you at? There he is. He'll be preaching Saturday night. That'll be the weekend, the only weekend you got left to be single. God help him. Pour it on him, Jesus. Maybe the Lord anointed him so much that he'll preach plumb into next Saturday past his wedding time and he won't ever get married. Amen. But we're looking forward to doing the wedding and also looking forward to hearing Brother Matt this coming Saturday evening. So, got nowhere to go, 7 o'clock this coming Saturday. We'll be here for a Saturday service. So come if you can, all right? Okay, let's go downstairs, children, because we're gone right now. Let's go. So we get started. Amen. Brother Bean, going downtown. All right. Praise God. God is good. Let me try that again. God is good.
Amen.
All right. Come on up here, Dennis. Come on, keep on moving. Come on up here. You sit right here beside Caroline. Come on. She made you a peach cobbler. You ought to come up here and sit beside her.
I love it, too.
Amen. Praise God. What do you think about that? Man, taking a peach cobbler and work on my truck, a steel charger, and fix my truck. What do you think about that? He said it was good, but it wasn't that good. That's okay. All right, let's go. 1 Samuel chapter 15 this morning. 1 Samuel chapter 15, Colossians chapter 3. 1 Samuel chapter 15, Colossians chapter number 3. 1 Samuel chapter 15, I'll be there first. Colossians chapter number 3, I'll be there 2nd, 3rd, 4th, 5th, somewhere down the road, I'll be there. Okay. All right. Everybody still glad to be alive?
Amen.
Anybody thankful to be saved today?
Amen.
Anybody thankful for the love of God again?
Amen.
My goodness. What a love. What a love. Amen. 1 Samuel chapter 15. 1 Samuel chapter 15. Colossians chapter number 3. Chapter Four Sundays ago, we began a series of messages, and we're still on that series. But the first message we talked about four Sundays ago, we talked about the avoided question. And we center that message around 1 John chapter 4, verse 17, where the scripture says, "As he is, Jesus is, so are we in this world." We've been talking about through these past four Sundays, we've been talking about becoming one body with him. In John chapter 17, Jesus prayed that prayer in his high priestly prayer that you and I would become one as he and his Father were one. The second message we talked about the reality of being one body. The reality of being one body. And we talked about the importance of a personal relationship with Christ, and we also stress the same degree the corporate reality of being one body. We are all one body. So our personal relationship with Jesus Christ has a direct bearing on you and I being one body. Your relationship with Christ, my relationship with Christ, will affect this house as a body of believers. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We come back the following Sunday, the next Sunday, which was a couple of Sundays ago, we talked about the result of being one body. The result of being one body. Our mission and our goal has not changed. It's no different than from the early church. We talked about that we are to be one for the purpose to become a revealer of God's glory or God's greatness in our life. We talked about the result of being one body, and our goal and our mission is, it hasn't changed, just like it was in the early church. Our goal is to be a revealer of God's glory and God's manifested greatness in our life. And the result of being that revealer and the result of being that one body is the latter glory will be greater than the former. No, you ain't got it. You ain't got it. Because you don't believe that. If you're still stuck in religious tradition, you'll miss that. The scripture says that the latter glory will be greater than the former. We have a tendency to doubt that. And as long as we have a tendency to doubt that, it will never come to pass. And as long as we struggle being one body with Christ, a church will never see it come to pass. There is a result of us being one body. And that result is seeing the latter glory being greater than the former. Amen. Amen, preacher. I believe that. Whether you do or not, I believe that. Amen. Last Sunday, the fourth Sunday, we also talked about the hindrances to being one body. Last Sunday was a very, very, very hard word last Sunday. And this Sunday ain't going to be no better. We talked about the hindrances to being one body. We talked about the hindrance of spiritual adultery. We have a concept of spiritual adultery, but most of the time our concept is not biblically based. It's what we think adultery is. But last Sunday was an eye-opener when we began to deal with the subject of spiritual adultery. In James chapter 4, verse number 8, James revealed to us, we talked about last Sunday on the screen, that a Christian whose loyalty is divided between God and the world, James says, is an adulterer. Now I know that's hard, and I don't like saying that, but that is the cold hard fact that James brought out in his writings. It was a very, very strong word last Sunday. And James also went and recorded in James chapter 4, verse 4 that we talked about last Sunday. He talked about indeed and living a lifestyle of spiritual adultery. We make ourselves an enemy of God. That's very serious. We are the ones that cause that, not God. God does not want to be our enemy. He does not have any desire to be our enemy. God loves you very much and very deeply, and he has no desire to be your enemy. But we make ourselves an enemy of God when we become an adulterer, a spiritual adulterer against God. When our loyalty to God is divided between the church and the world, between God and the world, James says we have become an adulterer and we become an enemy of God. I didn't say that. The Bible says that. I'm much too kind to say that. So today we're going to go a little bit deeper in the message. And we're going to talk about the hindrances of being one body as we talk about idolatry in the believer's life. Idolatry in the believer's life. It's going to be tough. Y'all hang on. Hindrance number two. The second hindrance that keeps us from becoming one body is spiritual idolatry. Now, let's talk about what hindrance means right quick and we can move on. Hindrance on the screen, we talked about last week, is a thing that provided resistance, delay, or an obstruction to something or someone. And there is a hindrance, there is a provided resistance, there is a delay, there is an obstruction to this church or to any other church that makes up the body to fulfill its mission, and that is to be a revealer of God's glory or God's manifested greatness. We cannot reveal God's glory or his manifested greatness in our lives, in our personal lives, as a body that has hindrances to revealing that glory and that greatness in our life. Can we get an amen?
Amen.
I'll take that. Even we got to take that. So today we're going to talk about the hindrance of idolatry in a believer's life. Now, most believers, when they hear the word idolatry, they think of people in these third world countries that bow down to these false gods. They think about statues and icons and temples and wooden gods or anything along these lines. People begin to think that because you and I live in the Western culture that gods, those kind of gods, are really not part of our culture. We don't have statues, preacher. We don't have icons or temples or these wooden gods that we bow down to. But when you began to look at our culture, you began to realize that our culture is really no different than any other culture. Because mankind has created every idol and every other god. Man has created it. And our Western culture has gods, many gods, that we have created. You ain't with me a while. You can leave after the service is over. And if you don't want to come back, I'll probably understand. Now listen to what I'm going to say. Every human being has an inborn awareness of God. As a matter of fact, Ecclesiastes 3:11 says that God has planted eternity in the human heart. In every human heart, God has planted eternity. So every human being has an inborn awareness of God. And to satisfy that awareness, it produces the need to worship. So what human beings do is we either worship the God that created us, or we seek an alternate version of some deity that is now beginning to be created in their own life. And then that person determines what's necessary to please that God or to please that idol, and that God will provide or allow whatever its inventor desires, all the while they are satisfying the need to worship. Every individual has an inborn awareness of God. I can prove that scripture, and I'm going to take time because I'm going to sift a whole lot of this message and get to where I need to be. I told Michael before I started, I said, I'm going to skip a whole lot of the beginning. I've got to get over where I need to be. Every one of us and every person out there in the world has an awareness there is a God.
Amen.
There is a creator.
Amen.
And that awareness begins now to to stir up worship in an individual. Whether it's Jehovah, it'll be some other God, but there is something you will worship.
Amen.
Something you will follow.
Amen.
Whether it be Jehovah or whether it be some God you create. But you will worship something. Preach on, preach on.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Y'all still with me?
Amen.
I don't know if y'all are not. Okay, let's get started. Now, I got to dig this thing out here. So y'all be patient with me and just continue to love me and continue to pray for me. Okay? Now, what is idolatry? Okay? For me to explain to you what idolatry is, I'm not qualified to do that. But this word is. So I'm not going to give you my opinion. I'm going to take you to the Word of God and show you from the Word of God what God considers idolatry. Got me?
Amen.
Can we go?
Amen.
Will you go with me today?
Amen.
I won't be too long. You know I'm lying. I told you. Okay, let's see what God's Word says about it. Let's start in the Old Covenant. And then we'll move to the New Covenant, all right? 1 Samuel chapter number 15, let's read, okay? 1 Samuel chapter number 15, let's read, verse 1. Samuel also said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you king over his people, over Israel. Now therefore, heed the voice of the words of the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, I will punish Amalek for what he did to Israel. How he ambushed him on the way when he came up out of Egypt. Now go and attack Amalek and utterly destroy all." What does all mean?
All.
"Utterly destroy all that they have and do not spare them, but kill both man and woman, infant and nursing child, ox and sheep, camel and donkey." Now let me stop right there for a moment. Now there is no mistaking God's will in verse 3, right?
Right.
Is there any gray area in verse 3?
No.
It's pretty direct. I mean, Saul was simply, here was the command. Saul was simply to go, he was told to go destroy, completely destroy, utterly destroy the Amalekites. Every man, woman, every child, animal. Why did God command him to do that? Because it was God's revenge for how Amalek opposed Israel when they were fleeing Egypt and they were at their most vulnerable point. So King Saul, when he heard the command, immediately mobilized his army and got them ready for battle. Let's read verse 7. Drop down verse 7. And Saul attacked the Amalekites from Havilah to the way to Shur, which is east of Egypt. He also took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive. He also took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive. He also took Agag, king of the Amalekites, alive. And utterly destroyed all the people with the edge of the sword. But Saul and the people spared Agag and the best of the sheep, the oxen, the fatlings, the lambs, and all that was good, and were unwilling to utterly destroy them. But everything despised and worthless, they utterly destroyed. Wow. That's something, isn't it? Huh. Did you catch that? Now, from the people, it would appear that Saul obeyed the voice of God. From the people's standpoint, Saul did good. He obeyed the voice of God. All right, let's read on. Verse 10, let's read on. Read on. Now the word of the Lord came to Samuel saying, "I greatly regret that I have set up Saul as king, for he has turned back from following me and has not performed my commandments. And it grieves Samuel And he cried out to the Lord all night. Watch now, watch. If you read this, you have to come up with this conclusion. That Saul did not give God the worship, the obedience that he deserved. Saul was not faithful to God. Do you agree with that? Okay. Now, we could say that Saul did 99% of what God told him to do. Right? So why did God look at what Saul did do instead of what little bit he did not do? I mean, he did 99% of what God told him to do. Why? I mean, you know, there's a scripture in James, it says, James 4:17, it says, therefore, to him that knoweth to do good, and doeth it not, to him it is what?
Sin.
Is what?
Sin.
Is what?
Sin.
Sin. So why did God focus on all that Saul did rather than on that 1% that he didn't do? I mean, see, to me like preaching, God's awful picky, isn't he? I guess you could say that. But to God, look on the screen. But to God, partial obedience, even almost complete obedience, is not obedience at all. Rather, it's rebellion. Now, look at me. I know. Listen. I'm not expecting any amens today. I'm really not. I come prepared for my own. But it's not going to determine what I've come here to do today. It's not going to change me from giving you an understanding of what idolatry is according to God. Not according to you and me, but according to God. Look at this. Saul obeyed 99% of what God told him to do. But that 1% in the eyes of God was rebellion.
Amen.
Now we look at ourselves sometimes and we see ourselves at what we have done, but yet we don't want to face what we have not.
Amen.
And what we are not. Help me, Jesus. Help me, Lord. See, what's one? See, here's what it is. Saul, it's not giving God the place of honor and the place of worship that is due him. And that is what, look at me, that is what Saul was doing in his disobedience to God. He was not giving God the place of honor in his life. Wow. Now watch, Samuel confronts Saul. Let me read a little bit more. Let's go. Come on, hang with me a little while. Verse 13, then Samuel went to Saul, and Saul said to him, blessed are you the Lord. Look what he said now. I have performed the commandment of the Lord. But Samuel said, what then is this bleating of the sheep in my ears, and the lowing of the oxen which I hear? And Saul said, well, everybody said, he said, they, you must have birds out there, did it. They have brought them from the Amalekites, for the people spared the best of the sheep and the oxen to sacrifice to the Lord your God, and the rest we have utterly destroyed. Samuel said to Saul, be quiet. In other words, shut up. And I'll tell you what the Lord said to me last night. And he said unto him, speak on. And Samuel said, when you were little in your own eyes, were you not head of the tribes of Israel? And did not the Lord anoint you king over Israel? Now the Lord sent you on a mission, and said, go, and utter the sword of the sinners, the Amalekites, and fight against them until they are consumed. Why then did you not obey the voice of the Lord? Why did you swoop down on the spoil and do evil in the sight of the Lord? This is what Saul said in verse 20. And Saul said to Samuel, but I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. Wow. And gone on the mission in which the Lord sent me, and brought back Agag, king of Amalek, and I have utterly destroyed the Amalekites. But the people took the plunder, sheep and oxen, best of the thing which should have been utterly destroyed, to sacrifice to the Lord your God in Gilgal. And Samuel said, has the Lord so great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice. And to heat than fat rams. For rebellion, wow, is as a sin of witchcraft. And stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because you reject the word of the Lord, He also has rejected you from being king. Look at verse 23. Let me pull this out. I'm on my way. You see those two words, is as, in that verse, two different times? Those words are italicized, which means they were not in the original language, which means they were added, the translators added those words to bring clarity to the scripture. Now listen, so the text would have read, rebellion is the sin of witchcraft, stubbornness is idolatry. Yeah. I want to say it on the second part of that because stubbornness is idolatry. Yeah. Now who would have ever thought that stubbornness would be considered idolatry in the eyes of God? Oh boy, here we go. Oh boy, I think I'm going to lose about half you stubborn people because y'all going to leave on going. Who in the world would ever thought that you could tie stubbornness into idolatry? Well, I didn't, but God did. Now listen to me. Let's look what stubbornness means. Then when we dig it out, we'll get out and go home. Stubbornness means an unwillingness to change. Oh my.
Come on. Yeah.
An unwillingness to change. It means having or showing dogged determination not to change your attitude or your position on something, especially in spite of good arguments or reasons to change your attitude, to change your opinion. You're stubborn. You won't turn. You won't change. You're like an old, I'm going to say it, you're like an old jackass. You won't turn.
Yeah.
I don't care. I said it anyway.
Come on.
I don't care. I said it anyway. We get like that sometimes. You might as well say amen.
Amen.
Stubbornness in the Hebrew means to pass or push. Watch now, watch. In other words, Saul pushed back from the truth. And he pushed back from complete obedience. Are you with me? Come to me. Come to me. Come to me. Because I want you to get this. So that tells me, from what I've read and what I gather out of this text, that tells me, next statement on the screen, when someone knows the truth, knows the will of God, knows what God has spoken, and yet pushes back and doesn't obey, it is idolatry.
Amen.
God. You should have stayed home today, you old stubborn thing. Hey, I get this way before you do, buddy. Oh, God. Lord, I'm preaching to a bunch of sanctified, holy people that ain't never committed a sin in your whole life. You lying bunch of you lying bunch of little sheep, you. That's a hard word.
Yeah.
That's a hard word, man. That'll skin you. That'll hair lip you.
Yeah.
That'll make you want to find another church to get out 12 o'clock. Talk to me, somebody.
Okay. Amen.
There it is, man.
Right.
But there's where Saul found himself. Saul knew. He knew the truth. He knew the will of God. He knew what God had spoken. Yet he doesn't obey. And according to God, he became stubborn in his stubbornness, and it became idolatry in the eyes of God. Amen. And the reason is, when we do that, the reason is because our will, our agenda, our wishes, our desires have been placed above God's.
Amen.
And all of these things come before God.
Yeah.
All of these things come before God. And an idol is anything that we put before God. Are we guilty of idolatry?
Yeah.
Wow. I wish I'd stayed home myself today. Hey, I'm talking about the hindrances, but let me tell you what's stopping the latter glory from coming and being greater than the former glory. Just exactly what I'm talking about.
Amen.
Amen.
because we become so laxed and so caught up in what isn't like God that we forget what God looks like. Ah, Jesus, I know, Lord, I've done her. What? Listen, Saul believed, and Saul even confessed to Samuel in verse 20, I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. Yet because he did not fully obey God, but rather chose to put the people's desire, or better still, his own desire above the word of the Lord, according to God, it was idolatry.
Yeah.
See, watch now, watch, come on, watch this, watch, the root of Saul's idolatry, it wasn't statues, it wasn't figurines, it wasn't altars or temples or bowing down to some wooden god, it wasn't any of that, folks, it wasn't any of that, but that's what most Christians tie idolatry to, but the root of Saul's idolatry on the screen was not giving God due worship and obedience to what God had revealed.
Amen.
There it is. Wow. I wonder how many times we've been guilty of the same crime.
Amen.
Wow, man, this is eye-opening. If you haven't noticed, I've been intentionally tying worship and obedience together. I've done that for a purpose. You know why? Because worship, when we think of worship, we think of the platform. And we think of a worship team leading a slow song with our hands raised and our eyes closed. And we think that's worship. According to the screen. But the truest definition of true worship is not music and singing, but rather obedience, man.
Amen.
That's the true meaning of worship. You know where I get that? Because the first occurrence in the Bible, the word worship, is in Genesis chapter 22, first book of the Bible. Genesis 22, verse number 5. And it deals with Abraham, the father of our faith. Abraham is speaking to his servants, and he's informing his servants about what he and Isaac, his son, are about to do. They're about to go up on a mountain. God told Abraham to go up on this mountain. I'll show you the mountain, and you are to sacrifice your only son, Isaac, to me as a burnt offering. And in Genesis 22 and 5, it says, and Abraham said to his young men, stay here with the donkey. The lad and I will go yonder and walk and worship. And we will come back to you. Abraham was not going to the mountain to sing a slow song. He wasn't going to the mountain to write a song. He wasn't going to the mountain trying to find musicians in order to have a worship service. Abraham had one thing on that mountain to do. He was there simply to obey what God had told him to do 3 days earlier, and that was to sacrifice his son.
Amen.
And Abraham said, we're going to the mountain to worship God.
Yeah.
Wow. So the first place worship is mentioned in the Bible is centered around obedience. And the root of Saul's idolatry was not giving God due worship, obedience to what God revealed. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Come to the screen. Next statement. We glorify and honor God when we obey Him. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
When we don't obey Him, we degrade or dishonor God when we refuse to obey Him. We can give lip service, we can even write songs about worship, we can brag about it, we can praise about it, and all that. But if we do not do what God desires, we insult God.
Amen.
Which is the opposite of worship or honor. Yeah. Y'all want to go home? Okay. Got two of you today with me. Listen to what God said to His people in Amos today. It's powerful. In Amos chapter number 5, this is what God said in verse 21. Look what God said to His people. God said, I hate all your show and pretense. Wow. The hypocrisy of your religious festivals and your solemn assemblies. In verse 23, God said, away with your noisy hymns of praise. I will not listen to the music of your harps. In verse 24, instead I want to see a mighty flood of judgment, of justice, and an endless river of righteous living.
Oh, yeah.
God will say, when I see an endless river of righteous living, when I see a mighty flood of justice, then I'll hear your praise.
Amen.
I'll hear your worship song.
Amen.
I'll hear your music. But until then, wow. And righteous living is not what I determine as God to live in. And righteous living is not what you determine as God to live in. Righteous living is obedience to God's authority. That's righteous living. So the question is, have you and I been obedient to his authority? Saul's idolatry was not giving God due worship and obedience to what God revealed. Are you being obedient to what God revealed to you? Or are you stubborn and committing idolatry in your disobedience? I ask myself that. You know what I find myself doing? Look at me. You know what your preacher does? He repents before God. You got a preacher, a pastor that has to repent every day just about. Amen. What do you think about that? Because the more I understand what God considers idolatry, the more I see in my life where I am falling short.
Amen.
And I can't plead ignorance any longer because now revelation has come out. You messed up when you come here today because you can't plead ignorance any longer. If you'd have stayed away today, you could still plead ignorance. I know you could have went on about your merry way and been all right, but now you messed up. You come in here today, you messed up.
That's right, amen.
You come in here today because now it's the end of the year gates, and now we're responsible now for what we've heard. Now we're responsible for what we do and what we don't do. Now we become responsible. Now we can't blame anybody because of our disobedience. We can't blame anybody because of the idolatry that we are committed against God. When we become stubborn and disobedient to God, God considers it idolatry.
Amen.
Serious crime.
Yeah.
Man, I know what y'all thinking. Same thing I think. Am I even saved? I don't know if I'm not, but no. But then I said, yeah, I'm saved. I'm still a work in progress.
Amen.
I'm still trying to reach that Christian perfection that I'm struggling with, man. Wow. Wow. Preach on, preacher. Can I go a little bit more? Will you not tar and feather me?
No.
I do love you. All right? If I didn't love you, I'd done sit you home at 12:30. It ain't 12:30. Yeah, it is. No, it's 11:30 coming home time. Are you still with me?
Amen.
Can I go a little bit more?
Yeah.
Can I go a little bit more? Just a little bit. I won't be too strong. Watch that. What? Stop. Stubbornness is idolatry. When someone knows the truth, knows the will of God, Saul knew the will of God. When someone knows what God has spoken, and Saul knew what God has spoken, and yet pushes back, does not obey, as Saul did, it is idolatry. Mm-hmm. It's stubbornness in the eyes of God.
Amen.
And let me say it one more time. The root cause of Saul's idolatry was not statues or figurines or some bowing down to some wooden god at some altar. The root cause of Saul's idolatry was simply not giving God due worship, obedience to what God revealed. Whew, wow. Man, this is good. Man, this is good. Listen to me. Many times the people who have a relationship with God and yet chose their own desires over what God has clearly revealed through his word. You know what happens when we do that? We become blind to our own disobedience, just like Saul did. Idolatry blinds us to the truth, whether you want to admit it or not, it does. I know you said the fact, no, it doesn't. Yes, it does. Yes, it does. It blinds us to the truth.
Amen.
We now have exchanged, when we do that, we've exchanged truth for deception. And now we begin to believe that God is on our side, just like Saul did. He said to Samuel, but I have obeyed the voice of the Lord. We think God understands our heart. And because he understands our heart, he thus condones our behavior and approves of our lifestyle. when in reality, we are in opposition to God and we made ourselves an enemy of God. Wow. I don't blame you if you leave. I don't blame. Stubbornness is idolatry.
Yeah.
Stubbornness is an unwillingness to change, to push back from the truth. The truth God gave, God revealed to you. The truth. That's an old covenant. Can I give you a new? Can I give you one more? Can I give you one more? You don't like that? That's an old covenant. I'm not under law. Okay. Let's go to new covenant. Let's go to New Testament, which applies to us. Colossians chapter 3. Let me take you here. I'm almost done. I promise. I'm not got a whole lot more to go. This is too hard to go too long. I can't take it, and you can't take it either. So I'll have to hurry up and get rid of this bad boy. Colossians chapter 3. Folks, let me ask you something. What do you think? What do you think these old patriarchs? What do you think these old prophets? What do you think they would preach today if they come into the house of God like this? These men skin you high, buddy.
Yeah.
You let a little old bald-headed theologian by the name of the Apostle Paul walk in the house, he clean house. You'd have revival or a riot, but you'd have one or the other. You'd be ready to fight, just like they did. You'd be ready to stone him and throw him over the hill, leave him for dead because you can't stand him. This Bible says the word of God is a sacred life, and the life is a sacred death unto death. It's a sharp, it's two-edged, it's sharp, man. It cuts you going in and coming out.
Yeah.
It's tough. This is what we need to get lined up for this end time move of God, for this life of glory. That's going to be greater than the former glory. We cannot enter into the ladder until we take care of the hindrances that's stopping the ladder of glory from coming. Am I making any sense, Mom? So let's go. Colossians chapter 3. Let's go. Let me give you a new text. I got to hurry up, man. Good God help me. Holy Ghost, please help me. Hurry. Colossians chapter 3. Let me hurry. Paul, verse 1. If you then were raised with Christ, how many of you born again? Put your hand up. I'm not going to look at you. If you were raised with Christ, okay, here's what you're to do. Seek those things which are above. Where Christ is. Say that to the right hand of God. Set your mind, your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For you died and your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Well, let me stop right there and say this. Watch it on the screen. Get this statement. Paul right now is giving us a key to remaining in a content state. That's important. Come on. I'm going to tie Saul right back here in a minute. He's giving us a key right now for you and I to get a hold of, to remain in a content state. All right? See, when we fully grasp, look at me, that we are in covenant with Almighty God through Jesus Christ, then we can begin to realize that we lack nothing, absolutely nothing, because we are in covenant with Almighty God. When you realize that, you can begin to live in a content state. Jesus said, the kingdom is ours. Matthew 6:33, Jesus said, seek ye first the kingdom, not second, not third, seek ye first the kingdom of God. And all these things, everything would be added unto us. Amen. When we seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness first. Come on, watch me now. Come on, let's read. Verse 5. Therefore, put to death your members which are on the earth. Here they are. Fornication, in case you know what that is, that's sex outside of marriage. Put it away. Put uncleanliness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Oh. Verse 5. Covetousness, which is idolatry. Right, there's the New Testament definition of idolatry. Covetousness. Oh, help me. I promise I'm almost done. Paul is saying, watch me, watch me. When we move out of contentment into covetousness, we move from a relationship of intimacy with God into idolatry and adultery. When we move out of contentment into covetousness, we move out of intimacy with God and into idolatry. Or adultery with God. Covetous. Listen. What does it mean, preacher? Okay, I'm glad you asked me. Okay. Here's what it means. Covetous. It means having or showing a great desire to possess something. A great desire to possess something. It also means inappropriate desire for more. Inappropriate desire for more. It also means the state of desiring more than one deserves or more than one's due. Watch. It implies a self-idolizing, grasping spirit. Mm-hmm. Covetousness. Watch. When our affections are not set on the kingdom because we haven't sought it first, watch me. What we do, we now begin to grasp for what we believe we need to be satisfied. Mm-hmm. We began to reach out there and we began to grasp for what we believe we need to be satisfied. Come on, somebody. Somebody needs to help me in this meeting.
Yeah, amen.
You sitting there like you don't know what I'm talking about. We all know what I'm talking about. Because we think we know what's best for us. We think we know what we desire to be better for us. And when we leave that place of contentment, listen to me, we began to seek out pleasure. Wealth,
amen.
Material gain, fame, status, position, reputation, companionship, fulfillment, power, authority, lust, on and on and on and on. And all that is outside God's kingdom. And we find ourselves in this state, watch me, when we are not content. Speak to us, folks. Contentment and covetousness is complete opposites. They are opposing forces. You know what contentment does? It moves us away from idolatry and closer to the heart of God. On the screen, while covetousness moves us away from God, distances us from God, and drives us to the altars of adultery, of idolatry. Are you listening to me?
Amen.
Contentment moves us from idolatry and moves us toward God, toward the heart of God. Covetousness does just the opposite. It moves us away from God and drives us to the altar of idolatry. And we begin to grasp what we believe we need to be satisfied. We fail to seek the kingdom of God first and His righteousness. And then we began to lean to our own understanding. And we fail to set our affection on things above. And covetousness begins to move in and moves us away from God because we are no longer content where we are with God.
Amen.
God.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 and 6. Hebrews writer said, would somebody say amen?
Amen.
Okay. Hebrews 13, 5 and 6 says, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have. For he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He said that so we can say, the next word we can say, so we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper, I will not fear. What can man do to me? Be content. Watch me. Watch me. Come on. Come on. Watch me. Come to go back to Saul. I'm pulling up a little Saul right back in the picture. So what fueled Saul's disobedience with the Amalekite? What fueled him? Why spare the king? Why? Why save the best of animals? When God's directive was so clear, why do that? Why disobey God like that? It was Saul's covetous behavior. Watch. Driven by Saul's insecurity and discontentment in the will of God. Statement on the screen. Because Saul was not content in the will of God. Don't sit there and look at me like that. Because we many times end up in the same place. We become discontent being in the will of God.
Amen.
Preach on, preacher. I'm going to. I'm going to preach on. I'm going to preach right on through this thing. I'm going to preach right on through this thing. I'm going to keep on going. Why does a man look at another man's wife and want her not his own? Let me tell you why. Discontentment with what he has. Covetous behavior driven by discontentment. You can say amen.
Amen.
You can say amen. Come on, you can say amen.
Amen.
Come on, you can say it.
Amen.
Why does a Christian seek pleasure or relationships that are not pleasing to God? Covetous behavior driven by discontentment, not being content in the will of God. Why do people backslide on God? Why do people go back to what they came out of? Not being content in the will of God.
Right.
Amen. Saul wasn't content in the will of God. Saul was driven by covetous behavior. Saul was driven. Insecurities and discontentment began to take over his life. Just like many times we do. Just like many times it happens to every one of us at times. So why spare the king? Why spare the king? Well, let me explain this, and I promise 10 more minutes and I'll be out here. Listen to me. Why spare the king? Well, you go back into those days, to conquer a nation was a very huge achievement. And what they would do very often, they would bring the defeated king to their palace, and they'd bring him there as a living trophy. And they set him up right there as a living trophy. And every time they glance at him, who would remind them? It would remind them of their victory. And when the king's servants and the people would look at the defeated king, it would remind them how powerful their leader was.
Uh-huh.
It was an ego and a confidence booster. Beneficial to them. Especially somebody that was insecure like Saul was. It became an ego booster. Look what I've done. Saul was very insecure as a leader. He could not see God as his source. Can you? Do you? Do you see God as your source? Or do you have the same insecurities? Or do I have the same insecurities? Why spare the best of the sheep and the cattle and the land and all that?
Mm-hmm.
If he gave the people the best of all the animals, what would it do? That would begin to serve as a reminder of his great leadership. And in times to come, they would reminisce and brag on Saul's strength and his strategy, how he attacked and defeated the Amalekites. Wow. Look on the screen. Let's take it, because I'm almost done. Saul coveted respect and honor from all of his people. Coveted that. Coveted. Coveted that. Wanted to be important. Now, we all like to be appreciated, but some folk like to be important.
Amen.
Watch. I'm almost done. I know. Somebody say, Lord.
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 Please help him get done.
Please help him get done.
Thank you. Okay. The Lord's going to answer your prayer right quick. Hang on a minute. Watch that. Let me see. Watch me. Saul, Saul was confronted by Samuel for his disobedience. Watch me. Watch. But Saul was more concerned about how his soldiers and his people would view him. Not that he disobeyed God. He was more concerned how we look in the eyes of the people. Look at 1 Samuel 15, 30, verse 30. Then he, Saul, said, I've sinned. Look what he said. Yet honor me now, please, before the elders of my people, before Israel, that I may worship the Lord your God. Not his God, your God.
Amen.
Wow. 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 Saul. Saul coveted respect, and he coveted honor and greatness and power more than anything else, more than even honoring God. Wow. Mm. This covetousness led Saul to stubbornness and disobedience to God's directive command. Covetousness is idolatry. Stubbornness is idolatry. Hindrances to becoming one body. Simply put, Saul was not content with the will of God. And that fits many, many believers today. Are you content? Are you content in the will of God? In closing, these scriptures I'm closing with. That's what I'm saying. And then we're going to pray and we'll go home. Leviticus 26 and 1. Back on the old covenant, you shall not make idols for yourself. Somebody say, I am not to make idols for myself. And anything you put before God is an idol. 1 John 5:21. Find the last thing John wrote, last verse he wrote in his first letter. Look what he said. He said, little children, keep yourselves from idols.
Amen.
What? John wrote that to the church. Last thing he wrote, that's the last thing he said to the church in his first letter. Keep yourself from idols then. What?
Mm-hmm.
What? Keep yourself, that's what I'm going to tell you before you leave, keep yourself from idols. Keep yourself from idols. Look at a statement, next thing, I'm closing. An idol becomes a source of something to us and a source of something for us. How? By fulfilling our covetous desires. Because sometimes our desires are not God's desires. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And that right there can happen in many areas of our lives. Next statement on the screen. An idol takes the place God deserves. Next statement, Mike. An idol takes the place God deserves. And it can be a provider of happiness, which is false happiness. It can be a provider of comfort, peace, provision, companionship. It can be a lot of things. But an idol takes the place that God deserves. And we are the ones who make the idol. We are. Look at me. And it's not always made with stone or wood or precious metal. Sometimes it's made of flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, Lord.
Amen.
Oh, God.
Amen.
Anything that takes the place that God deserves is an idol. Idolatry. Wow. An idol can be anything that we put before God in our lives. Wow. And then it becomes what we love, what we like, what we trust, what we desire. And we give attention to it more than we do the Lord.
Right. Amen.
We give attention to it more than we do the Lord. It becomes what you draw your strength from. It becomes what you give your strength to. Here it is, on screen, last statement, I'm closing. Here it is. And here's what happens. A believer, and believers are, they're drawn into adultery when he or she allows his heart or her heart to be stirred with discontentment and begins to look for satisfaction outside of obedience to God. Outside of his will.
Amen.
And we begin to enter into idolatry. Wow. And that satisfaction right there, look at me, that satisfaction right there, look at me, could be a person. Could be a possession. Could be some activity. Could be some pleasure. Wow. Think of these.
Come on.
I thank God I'm going out of town today. Look at me. Idolatry is not just bowing down to some statue.
Amen. Come on.
Idolatry is not just carving out some wooden god. Look at me, church. Honor God. Worship God as your source.
Yeah.
Look at me. And reject choices that will lead you away from Him. Amen. Preacher, I don't like you today. But I'm sorry you feel like that. I really am. It does alarm me, but I'm sorry you feel like that. It's not going to change my mind. I now have an understanding of what spiritual adultery is, and now I have a better understanding of what idolatry is.
Amen.
And I found out that I have committed an ignorance of adultery before God.
Amen.
You probably haven't, because you're much better at this than I am. But I found out in my own life that I've been doing things in ignorance that I got to stop.
Right.
I got to change direction here, son. I got to do something here. I don't want to be found like Saul. I don't be so stubborn that I refuse to turn. Like an old mule. Y'all thought I was going to say something else. Well, I need to stop your ears. Matt was reading that in the scripture not long ago. First time he preached here. He read that and he come across the word ass, and he wouldn't read it. So I ain't reading that. So he done his stuff to do something. I said, that's in the Bible, man. What matter if you read that part? Hey, I've been known to be stubborn as a jackass at one time. I can tell you that. I'm not saying that because I've been. What can I say, man, God?
Amen.
I'm trying to help you, man. I'm trying to get you to dodge a bullet.
Man.
You could probably go to 200 churches. There ain't no preacher's right mind preach that today. There ain't no preacher's right mind but dare to attack this thing. You can't do that. You can't do that, preacher. You can't do that. Well, I tell you what, I would rather know what idolatry is here right now than when I stand before God. I want to know that my stubbornness in the eyes of God is idolatry. I want to know that covetousness is idolatry in the eyes of God. I want to know that. And I want to know what I'm doing to cause idolatry in my life. I want to know what I'm doing to stop the flow of being one with Him. And I want to know what this church body, what's hindering us from entering into the latter that's going to be greater than the former. And whatever we can do in the Word of God to pull it out and expose it, that's what we need to do. But whether if you're offended today, I really don't care. It's the Word of God. Don't get mad at me, man. I'm just a messenger. Get mad at the Word of God. Get mad at God. Don't get mad at me. I didn't write the book. If I wrote it, I'd probably left that out of there. Because I'd probably do something in there. I can't put that in there. I'm doing that. I got quit. Hindrances to becoming one body. We talked about spiritual adultery, and now we'll talk about idolatry. Remind me when we leave today not to come back for 3 or 4 days. Give them time to heal up. Amen. God is good.
Amen.
You know something? And I have been so at ease with this, I haven't even sweated. You know why I haven't sweated? Because I haven't gone myself crazy, because this is going to slow down today. We got to hear what you want to hear at all.
Yes.
We got to hear what you want to hear at all.
That's right.
We got to make the right concessions to get this stuff in the right order.
Amen.
And get our lives back on track.
Amen.
4 Sundays in a row, we've repented. Guess what? Number 5 ain't going to be no different.
Amen.
John the Baptist had one message: repent. Jesus came on the same first day. He said, repent. Why would we change the message? Repent. If there has been idolatry in your life, repent of it. If there hasn't been, then you're one of the few that are perfect in here today. And we want to learn from you. So don't mess up. Don't mess up. You be our example to where we can follow you. Okay? You love me?
Amen.
You don't do it. Can we pray before we go?
Yes.
Okay, we'll go pray. Two altar calls. Let me get this for you.